Just a few of us.
I have to agree with James. Can I make a thought here?
Sure.
You make me think of something. And I say this with all due respect to the media and to Larry King, but for all the time that is spent on things that cannot resolve with any certainty, that cannot take the mass consciousness in the place where you, James, and George, and I would like to go, that is to greater exploration, imagine if the people that are listening to this show tonight that cared about it and that live in the U.S. Contacted the Larry King show and said, hey, now that we've seen enough of the lights in the sky, how about a case that's really got substance and you know, grill this guy on it or move the dialogue up? Because, look, Coast to Coast has had me on 7 times, and George here, as far as I'm feeling it on this end, is the person being interviewed, really knows how to go boom, 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 one question after another. And it would be great if we had a daytime or even early evening TV show that would be willing to do half the job he's doing.
Well, I appreciate that. James, is that your question?
Another question is, yeah, why can't we just get more information during the day, more posts, more... more sightings on regular newspaper, and
I'm sorry to interrupt you, but that's a whole other topic for a show sometime. I'll tell you, because you know there's a lot of dynamics going into how the media covers and doesn't cover UFOs and paranormal topics, and we need a lot more time than say the 10 minutes that we have left. So thanks for calling in, James. We're going to go to the wild card line now, Corey in the great state of Texas. Corey, good morning.
Hey, good morning. How you doing?
Okay.
My question is, has Mr. Myers ever discussed about how those alien fellers' political structure works? Do they have government or monarchy or anything like that?
My best understanding from the material that I've read myself and that is available is this. They struggled through what the kind of dog and pony charades that we have that is called the political process until they realized that all it ever brought them was war, and that trying to solve the problems by the same means that they are created didn't work. And they are, of course, you know, high-tech warriors and space travelers. So what they did is they came to terms with the fact that they would elevate to the positions of leadership in their world, or worlds as the case may be, those persons who were simply the wisest, the people with the greatest spiritual, philosophical evolution, who were duty-bound to assist others, not to capitalize, not who were power-hungry and lived for polls and all the rest of this nonsense, and who couldn't tell the straight truth unless they had 20 people telling them what other people wanted to hear. So they got rid of political parties and the process, and all of their leaders, and they have leaders, are required to live in the same way and do the same amount of work that all other citizens, so they don't have a hierarchy in terms of, whether it's capitalist or communist, where there's people getting the cream off the top and living off the fat of the land. They live a principle-oriented, not an advantage-oriented political system.
Thanks, Corey. Appreciate that question. That was a good one. We're going to go to the other wild card line now. Jan in Brooklyn, you're up mighty early or mighty late. Jan, what's on your mind?
Hi. Two quick things. You talked about that the commandos are waiting to unleash something really horrible on us.
Let me...
One other thing. Is it going to be soon? And also, you talked about chips being put into us. Now, I know chips make us very weak. Have any idea how the people in the United States will react to this?
Some people are already embracing it in Florida. They're thrilled that they can go through the checkout line in the supermarket and wave their arm or go into a club and buy their drinks by having a chip implanted in them. So it's underway in many ways, and it'll be sold to people as cleverly as possible. As for your first question about terror commandos, that came from the prophecy that Meyer published in 1958, basically what he was foreseeing at that time, because later in that prophecy he speaks about Islamic terrorism and wars between the major religions, and he's published information on some of these specifics before the events happened. I even have it on one of my DVDs where he foretold the riots in France from basically Islamic inhabitants who would riot, and I read that in 86. I put it on my disc in 2004, and it happened in 2005, but to fine-tune, that idea... You could call sleeper cells. It's something that we've come to know, certainly our intelligence people are well aware that's a grave danger. And with the fact that we've had these porous borders and with people who come into the country and change their names to Hispanic-sounding names when they actually come from the Middle East for nefarious reasons, it's presumed, I'm free associating at this time of night. But look, there are problems here, and we are not protected against them by the politicians who basically allow these things for their own short-term gains.
All right. Thanks, Jan. That answers your question. I think we're going to go to our international line. Mike is up late or early in Victoria, British Columbia. Got a lot of Canadians listening tonight. How's it going?
Hey, thanks, George. Thanks for having me on, and thank you, Michael.
You're welcome.
And, yeah, we love to listen to you up there. That's why there's a lot of listeners. I come from, I guess I want to bring up an organization that I don't think, you know, gets heard about. It's called GuideOn.org, and that's helping out, children that have lost a family member in combat in Iraq and Afghanistan. But, yeah, the question I got is, I was stationed at a joint command in the States in Colorado, and I came across, I remember this is years back, but there's message traffic about the Myers report. There is a Myers report in one of the message traffic that they're talking about propulsion engines, and they were studying them in Great Falls, Montana.
Mm.
And I'd like to know more about that. I didn't understand it at the time, and then it clicked in my head when you were talking about this topic. And then is there such thing as, like, are we going to be going into this interdimensional travel? I mean, you know, a lot of things like that.
Thanks, Mike, for those questions. Yeah. We got about 3 minutes left here.
Let me go backwards. I don't think we're into interdimensional travel, let alone real space travel, for some time. We're not leaving the Earth quite yet. We haven't even figured out how to live on it. The idea about studying propulsion engines, I don't know exactly who he's referring to. However, I can tell you that in 1979, David Froning, a scientist, astrophysicist in the defense industry, saw Myers' information and material about hyperspace propulsion. He was amazed. He wondered how a Swiss farmer could know about tachyons, let alone tachyon propulsion systems that would propel at above light speeds that were within 20% of the figures that he and a small group of scientists were coming up with doing complex calculation formula work. And he was not sure that they were right and Meyer was wrong. But he said this, whoever is advising this man is very knowledgeable. Myers' information, and he came to a presentation of mine and said that they may have made breakthroughs in their understanding of zero-point energy from Myers' material.
Along those same lines, we didn't have time to get into it tonight, but one of your other forms of proof are these sound recordings. Is that the engine? What is that, the sound
of
the beam?
Those were deliberately generated frequencies by the person piloting the ship because there's rotation involved, apparently, in how they create their propulsion. So there were various frequencies simultaneously generated that exceed the capabilities, certainly, of the synthesizers of the day and maybe even today. No one's been able to duplicate it, and there's a lot of interesting stuff about that. I don't think I can get into and get out of in time.
I would also like to ask you about the propulsion system itself in a minute. Can you say, or do you know what it is?
They have a couple different types, and I know little about it. Beam type of propulsion and tachyon drive and stuff like that. They also now have instantaneous transmission that doesn't require flying per se or even being in a ship, from what I understand. You know, kind of Stargate type of stuff. But it, as interesting as it is, it's nothing that I'm very knowledgeable about. I don't know how much information is there, but there are physicists who I see there in Switzerland every year who do meet with Meyer and are discussing a lot of this stuff.
All right, Michael Horn, thanks very much. The controversy will go on. I thought it was a really interesting interview, and you answered the question to your best of your ability. You got this new film out called The Silent Revolution of Truth. People can find out more information on your website, right?
Yes, and if they come to the UFO Congress or any of the screenings, we can talk in person, because I know there's a lot of questions out there, and I'll never be able to return all the email.
All right, now, theyfly.com is the website. Thanks, everyone. Thanks to the folks at Premier Radio for their great job. I'll be back next Sunday night with a whopper of a conspiracy cover-up type story. Not what you might think, though. I'm George Knapp on Coast to Coast AM. Good morning, everyone.